Mike will pick up.
We want to hear you.
I'm Susan Cox, and my pronouns are she, her. Welcome. I am so happy you're all here to celebrate Jay and us 19 years. At some point this afternoon, I hope you laugh, tear up, reflect, appreciate, and connect.
Timers who remembers UUCC before Jay Leach. Our son was the first member of the family who met Jay when he talked with the youth before he was hired. Jay made a good impression on an adolescent who wasn't easy to impress. And when he came back as our minister, he remembered Daniel. Just the fact that Jay keeps track of and connects with all the people passing through a congregation this large is something that I find amazing. But I want to remind us of some of the big things that Jay has guided us through. Soon after he arrived, Jay challenged us to stop letting other people define us. Many of us, youth and adults, did credo statements under his guidance that focused on what we give our hearts to, not whose theology we've rejected. Under Jay's leadership, we were at the forefront of marriage equality at a time when that was not at all mainstream. Many of us marched together in the 1994 Pride Parade at a time when there were no corporate sponsors and we were the only house of worship represented. Jay challenged us to talk honestly about money and stewardship. That led me and many others from making a nominal contribution to stepping up in a way that reflects ownership and commitment to our community. In an early attempt to focus our social justice efforts, this congregation chose to throw ourselves into fighting homelessness and supporting affordable housing. We didn't solve that problem, but a lot of us connected with people and organizations that opened our eyes. After the Charleston church massacre, we went deep into racial justice, followed by a broader look at intersectional justice. Jay warned us that this would be hard and make us uncomfortable. Yep, he didn't lie. We still have a lot of work to do, but I can say that the work I've done here has shaped the way I function in a diverse workplace, which in turn ripples out into the community. But of course, what has touched me most deeply was the personal ministry. When my father was dying, Jay spent a couple of hours listening to mom's memories to plan the service. When my brother died in the early months of the pandemic, Jay was on the phone to talk me through. And when I decided at a fairly late stage of life to make the leap out of a longtime career without any guarantee of what came next, we hashed it out over a long lunch at Red Sea. And when Jay decided to do the same, we replayed that lunch, but the roles were reversed. As a journalist, I sometimes imagine what it would be like to see a map where everyone I've connected with appears as a light. The deeper the connection, the brighter the light. I invite you all to imagine that kind of map for Jay. If you have a vivid imagination, you're grabbing your sunglasses, because the lights from his deep connections would create a blinding glow here at 234 and throughout our city. Now think about all the people scattered across the country who have been touched by Jay's work with UUA and Star King, moved by words from his sermons, inspired by something he said at a rally, or just encouraged by the presence of a place like this. I'm pretty sure I could look out from the plane I'm in today and see Jay's light twinkling. Jay, thank you. We'll honor you the best way we know how, by keeping that light alive.
The year was 2003, and seven members of the UUCC were nominated to the Ministerial Search Committee to find this congregation a new minister. We were a dynamic group consisting of Chris Clark, Nancy Green, me, Rita Heisinger, Martha Nisley, Lou Palumba, Randy Peacock, and Kathleen Udzik. Five of the seven of us are still around. We met every Monday night for a solid year at Lou Palumbo's home. The UUCC being one of the larger congregations in North Carolina, along with being located in the growing city of Charlotte, was considered a desirable position for many candidates. Let's look back at 2003. Gas was $1.59 a gallon. The United States Department of Homeland Security officially begins operation, and we all now can do this pose at airports. Voters recalled Governor Gray Davis from office and elected Arnold Schwarzenegger to succeed him. Apple launched iTunes and sold over 1 million songs in the first week. Basketball legend Michael Jordan retires. The five most popular TV shows are CSI, American Idol, Friends, The Apprentice, and ER. 2003 was the year that gave us the still amazing Pixar movie, Finding Nemo. The space shuttle Columbia crashes. Joys and Concerns was part of our service, and the use of pronouns hadn't yet evolved. The UUC's mortgage balance in 2003 was around $375,000. Today, it is zero. We have paid it off. Now, Jay, on to you. When we first interviewed you, you promised us that you would never be a minister that would wear chalice jewelry. Remember?
I've kept that promise.
You sure did. You did drop the corporate spiky hair, but adopted this post Grateful Dead long hair look. You gave up the suit and tie, but thankfully, and we are so grateful, that you never went David Tepper on us with open shirts and gold chains. Thank you so much. You bedazzled us with your literary skills, and I never knew that the word cacophony could have so many meanings. Even your adjectives and adverbs, well, have adjectives and adverbs. I'll say that again. Even your adjectives and adverbs have, well, adjectives and adverbs. Did you see that? That's called the J repeat. Yourself, you challenged us, you supported us, you comforted us, you loved us. And for me, you will always be the epitome of the quintessential minister. We made the right choice in 2003, and that still rings true today. Be well, and always remember, you made a difference. You are leaving us in a better place.
Never really had an opportunity to play it. Until now.
It's a song called The Relevance Rag. And it was obviously probably written back in the 60s, judging by some of the contextual commentary in here. But it's a lot of fun to do. And if you want to sing along with it, the chorus goes like this. We're relevant. We're relevant. Although it's sometimes hard, we stay in the avant-garde. We're the wave of the future, and religion is our bag. We're doing the relevance rag. That's it. So I'm gonna, if you're up for it, let's go with that. So we're relevant. We're relevant. Although it's sometimes hard, we stay in the
I'm Tom Nunnenkamp, and my pronouns are he, his. This recorded presentation is a much edited version of what I was going to present today in person. That is before Lib and I tested positive for COVID earlier this week. Following such a poignant presentation as Ann's is difficult. She did a wonderful job of pointing out the many ways our congregation has benefited by Jay's presence among us. She also did a beautiful job of relating his effect on a personal level. I will continue by mainly focusing on the personal. Jay, I have treasured our time together over the past 19 years, whether sharing lunches at Koishi, musing over some current congregational challenge, or talking about our love of music, or emailing each other during Atlanta Braves games, or sitting on the stone bench in Maple Walk, contemplating on what the UUCC might look like on the other side of, ironically, COVID, these hours together will be the ones that I will cherish forever. For the rest of you, be thankful I didn't regale you with why Alex Anthropoulos is the best general manager in baseball, or weighty topics like can or should white musicians play the blues. Earlier this month, longtime friend and congregant Richard Pratt and I were reminiscing about our first small group encounter with Jay, where he made several comments indicating that, unlike some ministers, he actually knew how to read balance sheets. And based on our financials, he was not convinced we could afford him, but he was interested in the job anyway. That statement for me describes this man that I love, respect, and to whom I owe so much personal growth. Jay was displaying his confidence in his ability to move this congregation forward and saw in us the possibility of being much more individually and collectively. And he was right on both counts. Did I mention we both love music? Bob Dylan famously asked, "How many times can a man turn his head and pretend he just doesn't see?" Apparently for me, it was about the time I really got to know Jay Leach. So after hearing Dylan's Blowing in the Wind, Sam Cooke is purported to have said, "A black man should have written that song." So he penned the classic, "A Change Gonna Come." And indeed, a change did come to the Unitarian Universalist community of Charlotte and to me in particular. The speakers today are expressing how Jay Leach impacted not only our congregation, but their lives in particular, and I'm surely no exception. While Jay and I have shared lunches, beers, did I mention music, our love of baseball and the Atlanta Braves, and long, sometimes very intense conversations, his most profound effect on me came from his desire for the UUCC membership to become more aware of our white privilege, and in particular, my privilege as a white cisgender male. It began for me in 2008 with a class on white privilege led by Kathleen Carpenter. That led to a class based on the book Waking Up White, and later White Fragility. I participated in evening social justice classes, and then thanks to a grant from our Memorial Endowment Trust, I was able to be a part of a group that met at Johnson C. Smith University on a challenging weekend where I dealt even more deeply with my racism. While I will probably be wrestling with this topic the rest of my life, my interaction with friends of color began to change. Our byline, "Cultivate Courageous Connections," now has real meaning for me. I now discuss white privilege and supremacy with my black bowling buddies and encourage some of my neighbors to consider history from a different perspective by reading the award-winning A People's History of the United States. Jay, maybe one of the reasons I have felt so close to you is that I see much of myself reflected. Like obsessing about things I care deeply and the frustration for those who don't share the same passion or commitment. My impatience with myself when I know I could have done more or done better, and the difficulty in forgiving myself for not meeting my own standards. It seems only appropriate that I end this mini tribute to my favorite reader of poetry by quoting the last line of a prayer I read most Sundays while sitting in the pews before the service. Harry Missouri wrote, "God of our mixed up, tragic, aspiring, doubting, and insurgent lives, help us to be as good in our hearts as we have always wanted to be. Jay, I love you, and we'll never forget our time together."
Jay, when I was told you were retiring, I said, "What do you mean he's retiring? You can't do that. You're supposed to eulogize me, and I'm not ready yet." I still expect that to happen. You have laughed and cried with us. You have sung and danced with us. You have emphasized the joy of the value of finding joy in life. And in celebrating Mardi Gras with costumes, beads, and hip hurrah, we have discovered community. Your creative sermons and memorable readings, to say nothing of the poetry, have inspired us. You have set lofty goals for us, and I suspect for yourself as well. So with our blessings, Jay, go out dancing. Go out dancing. Go out dancing.
Nice haircut.
I'm Mick Ellen Starr. My pronouns are he and him. Who remembers Follies? For those of you who are uninitiated, we put on a full-scale musical, farcical comedy every year for more than 20 years that we wrote and staged ourselves. Jay was in about half of them. Now, we haven't done that for a few years, but our creative brain trust from Follies included Pete Moore, Rita Heath Singer, and Belinda Perry the last several years. Pete and I have assembled kind of a Best of Jay in Follies video. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Everywhere I go, Jay.
Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine.
Cut.
Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Don't go everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Beautiful, both of you.
Well, that's a hard act to follow. My name is Judy Love. Is this in the right height? My pronouns are she, her. Different, little bit of a different tone here. This May, I flew to Boston to attend the memorial service for my childhood friend, Mary. It took place in a beautiful old chapel her family had attended her whole life. And yet, because it was a formal, almost anonymous religious ceremony, it could have been anybody's memorial service. I recall the stark contrast a few weeks ago when Susan Cox texted me to ask about Jay's involvement in my late husband Roger's memorial service. I'm sure many of you have heard me talk about this before, so bear with me one last time. It has been nearly 6 years and still the memory of Jay's ministrations explains the immense disappointment I felt at Mary's service. Through the 10 or so years that Roger attended the UUCC, he and Jay had had many in-depth conversations about philosophy and religion. Roger had contributed to and even led several services. Jay knew Roger at a deep level. A few days before Christmas in 2016, Roger came home from the hospital under the care of hospice. In his inimitable, uncanny way, Jay must have sensed that he was needed, and he stopped by to visit. I remember how Jay courteously listened while Roger's son Zachary loudly extolled the wonders of his new tractor. Meanwhile, Roger was quietly working on the business of moving on. Rather unexpectedly, with a big sigh, Roger passed away. Jay gave me one of his long, life-affirming hugs and stayed with us until the hospice nurse was on her way. Early the following spring, we scheduled Roger's memorial service. Still reeling from Roger's death and the minutiae of settling his estate, I was overwhelmed with relief and gratitude when the UUCC stepped up to help with the service and reception. Jay guided me through the whole process. When he invited me to his office to reminisce about Roger, Jay must have been secretly taking notes, for when he gave his eulogy, everything we had talked about had been crafted into a beautifully poetic paraphrase of Roger's life. Anyone who attended the service would have left feeling that they had known him forever. Having been a member of the UUCC for going on 15 years now, I have attended many of Jay's memorial services. Each one of his eulogies captures the departed in ways befitting our loved ones. As we near the end of our 19 years with Jay, many of us have joked that we had better make our final arrangements sooner than we had expected. What will we do when he is gone? Who will enumerate our many virtues and forgive our foibles? For your unfailing attention, your incomparable eloquence, and deep love, we thank you, Jay, for you have given us more than you can ever know.
I feel I'm Fred Dotson. My pronouns are he, him. This is going to be a discussion about Jay Leach in a couple of minutes, but first I want to talk to you about nuclear submarines. A young Naval Academy graduate entered the office of Admiral Rickover 70 years ago. He was seeking a job in the emerging nuclear submarine program led by Rickover. You thought I was kidding, didn't you? Rickover was known to be a very difficult person and an intimidating interviewer. He started the interview by asking questions unrelated to nuclear energy or the Navy or submarines. Instead, he quizzed the young man about classical music, opera, and literature. Fortunately, the 27-year-old graduate was a brilliant man. He was curious and well-educated, so he handled the questions easily. The last few questions, however, were challenging. He was asked by Rickover, where did he rank in his graduating class? Well, he proudly answered that he was 59th in a class of 820. Then he was challenged with this question. Tell me, Rickover asked, did you always try to do your very best? The young man started to answer the question, but even then he was the humble and honest man that we know today as Jimmy Carter. He answered, no, sir, I didn't always do my very best. Finally, Rickover asked a question that Carter could not answer, and still cannot. He asked simply, well, why not? Why did you not try to do your very best at all times? Carter had no answer, and the interview was over. He was offered the job, but he contends to this day that it has bothered him that he could not respond to that question. That brings us to the humble and honest man we celebrate today. I've had the pleasure of watching him in action for the past 19 years, and some of you can say the same thing. Can you think of one occasion where Jay just kind of phoned it in? or he seemed unmotivated or disinterested? Of course you can't think of a single time. Now, he would probably answer Rickover's question the same way that Carter did, but we know better. I'll conclude by saying this. For some reason, people like to give me these gratitude journals. You've probably seen those. I have a few blank ones at home, and I have a few blank ones at work, but I just want to let you know I'm okay, right? I'm good. But let's pretend I completed one this morning. I completed maybe half a page this morning in my gratitude journal. I'd simply say that I'm so grateful. I'm so very grateful for so many things. I'm grateful that Jay taught me how to pronounce the word idea correctly. That you have to emphasize the I, right? And it's idea, right? And that he taught me to find the beauty in the extraordinary and the ordinary. He's helped me create a solid and lasting bond between my head and my heart. And I'm so grateful that he's always given us his very best. Thank you, Jay.
Did a sermon when he was here for the week of his audition. when we called him 19 years ago. I remember feeling then that I and we would become better people with him leading us. That has been true for me over and over. A recent example. In May, Jay led a service on compassion, vengeance, and humanity's repeated propensity to wage war on each other. I watched it a few days later as I was traveling on that Sunday. I'm nodding along in agreement. Of course, war showcases our worst selves, and we should be aspiring to a peaceful world. Then he slides in the assertion that our faith calls us to refuse to dehumanize anyone, even those with whom we vehemently disagree or dislike. I start feeling a little uncomfortable. Listen, he says, to our discourse and the ways we speak, for instance, of our political adversaries. It starts feeling like he's talking directly to me. I wince, do a mental check-in. Have I ever actually told him that I have a hit list? With, you know, people like Putin, Donald, Mitch, Ted Cruz, you get the gist. I have visions of getting them all in one room and, well, you pick your fantasy of what happens next. Clearly, he is talking to me. Clearly, I don't want to hear what he is wanting me to hear, because those people deserve, okay, never mind. By now, I'm celebrating that I was not in a pew when he was saying all this, because I know he would have locked eyes with me. What price does this contempt and scorn exact on our soul, he asks, not so rhetorically. What do these vengeful thoughts do to our aspirations to honor every person's worth and dignity? We could, instead, aspire to be among those making the world a little kinder, even or maybe especially as we struggle to advance our ideals. Well, dang it. Do I get points that no one I personally know is on my hit list? No? Okay. You know, Jay, with your departure, the number of people in my life who consistently call me to be my better self is literally cut in half. It's difficult to imagine you not being a part of my world and my growth. You have been large and strong and courageous, and I have learned so, so much from you. I am better because of you. We are better because of you. I am grateful. Please join us now in Freeman Hall for dessert and another opportunity to share with Jay what he has meant in your life.
See that there are probably some people who remember a TV show from the 50s called The Roy Rogers Show. I see a few people in here that might, maybe one or two people from that generation. And whenever the credits rolled on the Roy Rogers TV show, there was always one song that played in the background. And as we bid adieu to the rootin' tootin' cowboy that we have had running the show for us for these 19 years as we watch the credits roll as he prepares for his next great adventure. And if you know the song, you can sing it along too. Happy trails to you. The trails that down here.